Lately, my focus has been on trying to understand the space on a kind of more holistic level between protocol level and application level, and trying to find similarities between them as opposed to NFTs themselves. I think that the NFT space in general kind of is a little bit of a bubble almost. They kind of like look at themselves and just are see what people are what's working in the NFT space and they try and replicate that, as opposed to maybe looking at the DeFi space, looking at the proof of stake space and see and replicate what works there, right?
Alrighty, ladies and gentlemen, we are back finally. It's been some time here, about a month, I think, with another episode of the Layer One podcast, where, of course, we are always trying to bring you guys the best guests. Special guest here with me today, my man Q, is up here in Pittsburgh. It's going to be a fun week. We got a little poker night action going on tonight.
Yep.
At the house. We got a big UFC fight this weekend, so we are definitely excited, and we got an exciting guest here today too.
We have one of the most exciting guests we've had on in a long time, so we'll introduce him in a second after I get my introduction in, because again, I am in Pittsburgh. It's snowing outside, of course, on my first day, but yeah, we won't make you guys wait any longer. We have Brian Flynn here. He works on products at Dapper Labs.
Many roles that he has there.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. So Brian, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great, guys. How are you?
They're doing great. We're trying to stay warm. We haven't done an interview in a long time. So it's been about a month since.
Oh, man.
So you got some big shoes to fill. We had Wax on last. But we're here to talk everything Dapper Labs. But usually we like to start off with some of your background before crypto. Everyone's got some type of background before crypto, of course. I did inform Mike that you were a professional gamer before this podcast, so he has to contain his excitement, but go ahead, give us that intro, Brian.
Yeah, sure. So how I got into crypto, so back in my high school days, this is about 8-10 years ago, I was playing a bunch of MMOs at the time. I was, grinding some levels in World of Warcraft, grinding some levels in some random MMOs. Eventually said, okay, this is boring. I was kind of competitive at the time. So I started playing some Counter-Strike. So I played Counter-Strike for about 3 years, got pretty good at it. Started playing kind of semi-professionally, joined some LANs and making some money out of it. And then the FPS scene was kind of my thing at the time. The FPS scene in general was like pretty dead after Counter-Strike Source. So I was looking for like what the next game was. And for a period of like 3 to 4 years, there wasn't a really good game coming up. So I was just playing a bunch of random FPS games with like a team, just trying to, make some side money doing that. It's kind of like my hustle, right? So then I had to make the really hard decision of whether I was going to go to college or if I was going to be a professional gamer, right? And like join a real team, be sponsored and all that kind of thing. And I ended up making the decision to go to college and kind of like scrap esports. Professional gaming, just because like this was right before it took off. I look back now and I'm like, well, shit, like there goes a career. But like, yeah, so I still have a lot of friends in the space. They're right now on like a bunch of Overwatch teams playing professionally. I talk to them quite a bit, but it's always good to look back and what could have been. But that's kind of how I found my entry into crypto. I was like really into gaming at the time. I was kind of the guy who played the auction houses and the economies and games a lot, trying to, make the most amount of virtual currency, right, when that wasn't real, right? So the concept of digital money was always there for me. So that's kind of how I found my way.
Yeah, you're kind of fulfilling that narrative that we always talk about, at least on this channel, where blockchain or gaming is going to bring in new users to the ecosystem. So tell me, like, what was the moment where you kind of saw the intersection between blockchain and gaming and crypto?
Yeah, I think when I got into space, it was probably sometime in 2016. I heard a little bit about Ethereum, heard a little bit about smart contracts and possibilities. And I instantly saw that, now there's actually ways to make money from playing games. And there's ways to kind of have these guilds become DAOs to some extent. I was already thinking, people are thinking that right now, but at the time, like, it was very normal for like guilds to play across games and actually, you know, have a guild bank outside of the game itself. I know the much larger guilds and MMOs did that as well. So that kind of clicked with me around 2016.
Gotcha. Yeah. I mean, it's funny. 2016, I feel like for me was that year where same deal, right? Saw Ethereum a bit, and it feels like kind of crypto as a whole just really opened up. So yeah, fascinating. Real quick on the pro gaming front, because like you said, I'm definitely excited there. I'm far from a pro, but I'm one of those guys who you know, likes to kind of put in the time and try not to get beat.
I carry this man through Apex Legends. So.
Yeah,
he's. Oh man, that's my game right now.
Nice. Yeah, well, don't play with me. Q is traditionally, yeah, you know, the guy who's never played the game, and I've been playing it for years, and he comes in and just.
What system absolutely do you guys play on?
I play on Xbox. He plays on PC. So.
Oh man, I play on Xbox too. We should play.
Definitely, man. Definitely, yeah. I'd need somebody else to carry me through. So perfect. But you know, obviously, like you said, esports, right, has blown up a little bit. Can you give us an idea of just what was that like kind of being a pro gamer, right? What's the day to day, you know, what's kind of that whole industry like?
Yeah. I mean, because I was in it before it got big. So to give you a year, this was like when I was at my peak, it was probably 2011, right? Like there were just a few sponsored teams, but they were mostly for games like League of Legends and the FPS professional teams they didn't have these big player houses like they do today. They didn't have these strict schedules, right? It was just like a bunch of guys who, you know, had these side jobs and just like scrims at night, right? They had like you know, hey guys, like let's scrim at like 7 p.m. tonight, right? And do that 5 days a week, right? So it isn't like you hear today where they have the player houses and they do all that crazy stuff together, the strict routines, right? But I think that at the time, it definitely was a lot of traveling, going to different lands, at least on the East Coast, because I'm in New York, and just trying to find like what the best tournaments are to participate in, right? It was always hard to always see like, okay, where's the best use of our time? I think today the games are a little bit more structured with their tournaments. So like each game has its own tournament itself. But for Counter-Strike at the time, there wasn't like that. There was like six different leagues going on at the same time. You had to kind of assess which one was the best use of your time.
That's awesome. So you kind of fulfilled our kind of check boxes here where we wanted to hear about gaming. I know everybody's here to hear about crypto and blockchain, so we'll get to that. I did have one question. How many times have you actually explained CryptoKitties? Like, I want a number amount. I feel like you guys over at Dapper Labs just have to answer these questions all the time. How many times?
I always leave Benny to do that question. So okay. Myself, probably not a whole bunch. I mean, definitely, you know, you have those family parties where people ask you what you do for a living and you're like, oh God. Here you go again, right? Mm-hmm. And try and explain that like CryptoKitties is what you do for a living to like your, you know, to your aunt is like the most awkward thing ever, right? But like, how does this actually make money in the first place? So, you know, it's probably at least a dozen times. You always get those awkward looks at parties.
Yeah, that's well, you know, when you're really kind of the name brand for dApps and or NFTs or whatever you want to call it at this point, you know, it's a lot for sure. So, you know, I brought up the point about the pro gaming, and like you said, you know, you were kind of in it right before it blew up. It feels a lot like dApps or NFTs are kind of at that point. And we definitely want to talk about your thoughts on, you know, whether or not this might be the year for dApps. That's always kind of a thing that happens in crypto. People like to say, hey, this was the year for DeFi, or this was the year for staking or whatnot. But before we get to that, just a little bit of context, maybe for people who just know you for CryptoKitties, but maybe not for Dapper Labs. Essentially, what is Dapper Labs? You know, what is underneath that umbrella that is Dapper Labs?
Yeah, sure. So Dapper Labs is a blockchain gaming company made popular for us by CryptoKitties, obviously. And right now that we have a blockchain gaming studio, and under the blockchain gaming studio, we have three different products. Right? We have CryptoKitties, we have NBA Top Shot, and we have CheezeWizards. So to do CheezeWizards first, so we launched CheezeWizards back in the fall of last year. We ran one tournament, and just it was a really interesting experiment at the time. But there was also a lot of confusion, right? So the way Dapper Labs approaches blockchain games is that we want to keep most of the gameplay on-chain and keep it truly decentralized, while a lot of other blockchain games make everything off-chain, right? I think that there are a couple of games that have on-chain, but they are in different protocols, like EOS and Tron and so forth, just because it's cheaper to have those transactions on-chain. But to keep like blockchain game on-chain on Ethereum itself is super expensive, right? Like just to have one transaction, like to, for a fight on CheezeWizards, but since we were paying the cost, it costs us like $4 for each different fight happen on CheezeWizards, right? It's like absolutely absurd, right?
Wow.
So right now we sunsetted CheezeWizards. We're probably going to have it back again maybe sometime this year, but we're focused on NBA Top Shot right now. So that's kind of the studio, right? The other part of Dapper Labs is the flow of blockchain, which I actually spend a lot of my time on, probably about like 80%. The flow of blockchain is a proof of stake network that's similar to some other proof of stake networks launching like Near or Solana. And it uses a multi-node architecture to achieve scalability and high throughput, and also preserve composability that's popular in some DeFi projects today. So Flow is going to be live sometime this year, probably in the first half of this year. And we're partnering with a bunch of games and having our own games on Flow as well. Those are the two parts of Dapper Labs.
That's awesome. And it's awesome. We didn't know beforehand whether you really focus on that gaming studio or you were like in the R&D with Flow Network. So it's great to hear that you're actually, you know, part of developing this Flow Network. For those people who are interested in Flow Network, because I feel like the announcement came 3-4 months ago, maybe I'm getting my timelines wrong, but for those people who maybe I heard about it months ago and, you know, are excited for Flow Network, first, my question would be like, what blockchain or what network does it resemble the most? Is it going to be proof of stake? Is it proof of work? And then how do you plan on, you know, getting developers over to Flow Network? Or are you guys going to be organically through your own development studio?
Yeah, that's a good question. It is a proof of stake network. I don't want to compare ourselves to any proof of stake network because we're completely unique, right? We take things, we have a much different approach, right? We're more of a traditional software startup as opposed to some of these blockchain startups. So we think in a kind of a different lens. We're a much bigger company than some of these other blockchain projects. What was the third part of your question?
I guess my other question would be how, as it goes with like, any scalable network, you're trying to attract users because you're focused on the user experience. Yeah.
Go ahead. So a big focus right now is developer adoption for us right now. Even before the blockchain is live, we want developers building on top of Flow, right? Right now we're focused on our Flow developer preview, which is just like a single node emulator. So people can start writing smart contracts on Flow with a JavaScript library. And that should be, right now we have a bunch of partners, both gaming studios and independent developers building on top of it right now. But we're going to release it to the wider audience probably sometime in February or March. So people can start writing their own contracts then. With Flow and developer preview, we have our own programming language called Cadence. So we've written so many lines of Solidity, probably top three out of any other blockchain company. And we realize how much it sucks, frankly. So we've taken the best of both Rust and Move, Libra's programming language, to kind of create our own based around this concept of resources, right? So resources makes building with existing objects much easier. It makes it so you can take an NFT and build on top of it much more practical than Solidity itself.
Yeah, I remember hearing about Flow for the first time when you guys came out with the announcement, and I was definitely impressed because, you know, it seemed like you guys were taking a very focused approach, right? A lot of proof of stake blockchains especially kind of come out and they say, you know, if we build it, everyone will come and they'll kind of build whatever they want. And as they try to do exactly that, they realize that, you know, resource management or governance or scalability or whatever the case may be won't allow them to build specifically what they want. So, you know, some other kind of details about Flow, right? What kind of money has been raised for Flow? is there going to be a token that's, you know, publicly available to people? Has there been a token sale? Kind of what's the status there?
Yeah. So when we did the announcement, we did a bridge round from our last raise. I don't think we have the amount we raised public available, but we will definitely, we would definitely have a token because we are a public blockchain, right? I think every blockchain has a token at some point. So we'll probably have more details on that and the token economics itself probably in the near future.
I don't think people realize how genius NFT and collectible fundraising is, because unlike ICOs where you're raising money and then people are getting these tokens and with the hope that maybe, you know, the network gets adopted or all these things, people that actually buy in to NFT collectible raise, like maybe the first round of CryptoKitties or the first round of CheezeWizards, they're actually getting a collectible in return and you guys are still getting the funding. So to me, it seems more sustainable that way than maybe just like regular ICO raises.
Yeah, no, I have a lot of opinions on this topic as well. I don't know if you want to go into it.
Go into it.
Yeah, the problem with NFT crowd sales as a whole, geez, hold on. These AirPods keep falling out of my ear. You know, the new AirPod Pros are they're too big at the outside, right? So it's terrible. Yeah, so the problem with NFT crowd sales is that developers take money up front and they're not incentivized to grow the value of the NFTs themselves, right? Unlike a traditional ICO where the developer keeps some of the tokens and like their future revenue is based off the token's appreciating value, doing NFT crowd sale, basically you're just like selling off your assets and then you have the money to appreciate, right? So I don't really like the model of doing an NFT crowd sale to raise money. And a bunch of these companies doing like land sales in general, it's kind of just a money grab for the most part. So we're really interested in finding new models, especially with NFTs, to align incentives between some of these blockchain game players and the creators themselves. But I don't think the right model has been found yet between any blockchain game project.
Yeah, I would say it definitely hasn't. And you know, obviously kind of the next step to that, that question, right, is if you have various public or private fundraising, you have those people who have invested in these projects trying to also at the same time figure out where value is accrued and why value is accrued there. So it's, you know, it is a long and kind of deep rabbit hole there that I don't think anybody has quite yet figured out. So on the Dapper Labs front, you know, obviously, you know, CryptoKitties was the first. It sounds like CheezeWizards isn't you know, a giant focus right now. You have the NBA game. Are there other games that are kind of in the works that you can talk about, or you want to keep them as a surprise for now?
Yeah, I mean, we definitely have some things in the pipeline that we'll probably announce soon. A big focus of ours is to, you know, we have a bunch of IP deals in the pipeline that we're really excited about that are like NBA. So getting these IP partners on board and some of the things we're working on is kind of our big focus for 2020.
So from a personal standpoint, you know, we did some research on you. We didn't send a PI or anything, but we know that you have that nifty newsletter, NFTY newsletter that you like to put out. And now I will subscribe, you know, after this, you know, so yeah, yeah, exactly. But tell us a little bit about that genesis of Nifty and what you're trying to accomplish by distributing that content.
Yeah, I think when I started writing before I joined Dapper, this was probably like February 2018. I was still brand new to the space. I was doing consulting at the time. I had a really interesting blockchain. I had a lot of good ideas, at least I thought, and I wanted people to see what they think of them. But I started writing kind of as like a single player activity, right? I wanted to clarify my own thinking by writing. And I started writing a lot, just like a bunch of like crazy, wacky ideas about like what NFTs can be used for, besides just like breeding cats together. And you know, it was pretty popular. Right now there's about 1,500 subscribers to that newsletter. But lately my focus has been on trying to understand the space on a kind of more holistic level between protocol level and application level and trying to find similarities between them as opposed to NFTs themselves. I think that the NFT space in general kind of is a little bit of a bubble almost. They kind of like look at themselves and just start see what people are what's working in the NFT space and then try and replicate that, as opposed to maybe looking at the DeFi space, looking at the proof of stake space and see and replicate what works there, right? Because both of them or all of them are open source projects at the end of the day. And potentially they could learn from those different layers as opposed to just looking at one specific bucket. So I think a lot of my writing has been more on like a reflection or like a philosophical level lately about like, okay, where is this space going as a whole on the consumer application level as opposed to just NFTs themselves?
Yeah, we listened to some of the previous podcasts you were on. They're obviously not as good as our podcast.
But, oh, wow.
No, just whoa, kidding.
Goodness.
One of the things you talked about there was, you know, like you said, that intersection between NFTs and DeFi, right? I mean, Ethereum really just continues to kind of offer different use cases as it grows. So as you're writing about this, as you're kind of reflecting, where specifically are some of the ways that you think you could see NFTs interacting with, you know, both crypto where it stands today and other things outside of crypto?
Yeah, sure. I think talking about the NFT and DeFi crossover is the best place to start there. So the concept of NFTs or blockchain gaming and DeFi in general has come to this thing called play to earn that you probably heard. Yeah. And it's this concept of like, you basically be able to play a blockchain game and earn some money by playing it, right? If you have some, you know, fungible token inside the game itself, like as you keep earning, you'll eventually be able to earn more of this currency. But as I thought more about it in probably the last 6 months, I'm a little bit more pessimistic on the crossover between DeFi and gaming. I think that the concept of play to earn itself is really hard to solve because you need civil resistance in place, right? So this concept of just like going out and doing a challenge in a game and obtaining a financial reward, you have this problem of people just creating a bunch of different accounts and trying to suck up that reward, right? So the players are not playing the game to enjoy anymore. They're playing a game to gain some financial incentive.
They're grinding,
yeah.
Farming, yeah, whatever you want to call it, right? Yeah,
right. That's kind of the problem with, I come back to this all the time, like Diablo 3 launched the auction house, right, when they first started, right? And so you could sell items for real money. But it did really poorly because you just had a bunch of bots just basically going through all the dungeons and basically just like picking up all the good loot and selling, and it crashed the prices of all the stuff in the game because it could be sold for real money.
So how do you fix that? Sorry.
Right. No, I was going to say the same thing.
Yeah, no, it's a really good question. I think that games right now, like Fortnite, benefit a lot by not being on blockchain, because being able to liquidate your items in a game would mean that the initial price of skins themselves would probably tank for Epic Games, right? Like the games themselves need to act like more of a escape from the real world than a way to make money in the real world, right? So I think you'll see the separation of both games for escape versus games to make money, right? I think it'll be at least 10 years before you'll have digital tokens and games themselves and functioning as real economies. I think Forte is doing a lot of work in this right now. We're trying to figure out how that exactly works. But it's probably going to be the hardest thing to solve is like, how do we actually play games to have these digital economy that aligns incentives between the creators themselves and the players. And so I think, as I said, it's still super unsolved.
Yeah, and obviously with everything happening in esports and gaming, you know, outside of blockchain and crypto, and kind of the explosion happening there. I mean, the news you see, right, in the traditional media is some 16-year-old wins $1 million for winning, a Fortnite tournament?
Fortnite.
Yeah. There's definitely a lot of action, right? It's not a kind of a dead space or a zombie space by any means. So there are always problems to solve in crypto. If it's going to take 10 years, that gives me plenty of time to practice. So, that's good news for me, but, it's starting to seem to me like 2020, is certainly kicking off strong, but kicking off with a lot of application, layer or kind of gaming focused projects and news, right? Decentraland came out with a big announcement that their platform was finally ready to launch. Obviously, you guys have been have been busy. We talked on our most recent Layer One Live, which is a live show we do on Mondays about, I think it was Enron or Elrond.
Elrond
was a gaming platform that was, you know, working with Samsung, and they've obviously been very active in the space. So all in all, my question to you, right, is do you see 2020 being kind of that year of the dApp, or do you feel like we're still so bleeding edge that you know, it's going to take still a few years before dApps grow like we've seen DeFi or staking grow?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think we'll see some form of dApp be super successful in 2020, whether it's gaming DAOs or gaming slash DAO slash DeFi. For gaming dApps themselves to be successful, they need to actually prove some type of value outside of games themselves, outside of just, you know, I'm playing this to make money or having true ownership or having liquidity in my items. There's been some talk of dApps that are more of like a membership economy. I think Unlock Protocol is a really good example here, where you can actually, you know, interact with celebrities or interact with your fans more if you have some type of token. I think right now that's probably what I'm most bullish on, is that some type of, you know, you have a token that you can access multiple different games or multiple different apps with. But the hard part is building a standard around that type of economy, right? So that standard needs to be implemented in multiple types of apps, so it's not just locked into one ecosystem, right? So I think a lot of these sidechains like Loom, Matic, they suffer from this problem of standardization. So it's really easy to create high throughput dApps, but they don't necessarily create much difference than, say, a normal game itself or a normal dApp itself, right? It looks very similar. You have this high throughput, and the ability to earn in those games is a differentiator, but it's not the right differentiator, right? Again, it's the, you know, you're playing to earn, but it's not an escape from escape, like, while people play games, right? So you're not attracting the right crowd, right? So I think the right type of dApp that you're going to see where it really takes off is one that's heavily standardized across an entire protocol layer, right? So something that, like, you can have a token and interact with, like, multiple different dApps at once, right? I think Neon District is doing a lot of cool work here of trying to create, you see, all this, like, multiverse of different ways. I've been spending a lot of time thinking about if we're going to be in a multiverse or a metaverse at first, right? Hmm. So, like, a multiverse being, like, are we going to interact with multiple different metaverses that are standardized, or are we going to be interacting with, like, one specific metaverse, like a decentralized, right? It's kind of cool to think about, but if the value capture and on dApps themselves or in metaverse is on the base layer, then people are going to be just craving their own decentralized competitors, right? People won't, like, live in decentralized itself, right? So that way we'll end up just having a multiverse, right? Multiple different metaverses exist.
That's fascinating. I mean, clearly you've been thinking about this. I got questions running through my head here now, but I, you know, you really brought up an interesting point about dApps that I think a lot more people are, they're becoming more comfortable with, right? And that is the idea that a dApp, a decentralized application, is not going to be fully decentralized if it's going to have any sort of mainstream success. So I'm not sure how many, you know, kind of full-on, fully 100% decentralized folks still exist in that realm, especially when it comes to dApps. You know, so I really just kind of wanted to touch on that point as a major one there. I think, you know, Elrond talked a bit about it, where, you know, they are a game that uses the blockchain technology that Elrond offers without being fully decentralized. So it'll kind of be interesting as the term dApp evolves and dApps right. evolve as we continue through. But yeah, it's so when it comes to dApps, right, obviously you guys have a lot going on. Is there anything else out there that really perks your interest, right? Is there another dApp or another studio, somebody that you follow who's a big project in the space or up and coming, you know, kind of thinker in the space around dApps or NFTs?
Yeah, I think what's going on right now with DAOs is pretty fascinating. So I've always, as I said before, I've been fascinated with this aspect of like having that relation like as a guild, like being able to form your own DAO and being able to play different games and earn rewards, split it with your guildmates, right? So I think between Meta Cartel and Moloch DAO, you're starting to see different projects evolve where like everyone has kind of their own role in their space and you're able to like assign tasks, right? And everyone has their own, and you're trying to create this revenue share between all the participants. So that's really fascinating. Right now, there's also another project called Saint Fame, which is like a decentralized clothing brand. It essentially uses Aragon DAO for voting on designs and for voting on who should be included. And it also uses Uniswap to distribute rewards and NFTs themselves. So you can imagine like an influencer using this platform like Uniswap to sell like Yeezys, for example, right? So instead of doing like a distribution, like kind of Supreme style where it's at a set price, it essentially uses a bonding curve. So like the market decides the price itself, right? So I think there's a lot of experiments going on right now in the Ethereum space to see if there's an appetite for that. So I'm really excited to see how those experiments come out.
Yeah, we've been kind of jumping around a little bit and I'm going to continue to do that here. But your metaverse and multiverse play that you were just talking about, I think it really clicked with me, like object or platforms like Decentraland, where some of the reasons why NFT collectibles haven't taken off the way that we would like them to is because although you have that like initial hype, and CryptoKitties still obviously has some hype around it, like the marketplace is still active, but like most of the reason why we collect things is to show them off to other people. And right now, there isn't a place. Like I remember listening to a podcast with Benny, and he was saying that one of the first times that he actually created a new CryptoKitty by breeding two cats together, it was from one of their developers, and it was just code. So he created this new CryptoKitty, and the developer was like, "You have your new CryptoKitty." He's like, "Where is it?" It's like, it's that line of code. It's like, well, that really doesn't click with me. So like when I see that Decentraland partners with CryptoKitties or in some form or fashion, you're able to move that CryptoKitty into Decentraland and now you can show it off to other people in Decentraland. That stuff makes sense to me. And it's what we don't have right now. So I really liked that talk about multiverse and in metaverse. And I've, you know, done some thinking on that, but And there's no question in there, but my question here is tell us something that we don't know about NFTs. Cause you know, we've had non-fungibles on, the guys from non-fungibles, but you obviously are working with NFTs and I know you want to move away from NFTs, but you've done so much in that kind of realm for a little while. Tell us something like we don't know right now about how NFTs can be used. You said building on top of NFTs and like, these are things that we don't think about on a day-to-day basis.
My favorite NFT project of all time is Ethmoji. Have you heard of it?
Mm-mm. Ethmoji, no.
So Ethmoji was started by the OpenSea guys before OpenSea. Mm. Maybe it was during a hackathon. And essentially the concept of Ethmoji was like, you can have a gravatar for your Ethereum address.
Ah, right? Okay.
And essentially, everyone can own these base components that are NFTs themselves. But as other people use those base components in their composition of the gravatar, they can earn royalties, right? So people were trying to evaluate the price of these base components based upon how many people use them in their own gravatars, right? Mm. So you can imagine things where people start using this NFT model where like, celebrities or IP owners start having these base components that formalize around the standard. And then they start saying, okay, these fans can start using them in their composition or use them in their avatar and then distribute the royalties to each of these celebrities and influencers, right? So it's another way to raise money or potentially another source of revenue for some type, these types of projects, right? So I think there's these models that we haven't fully explored as a full space that have been tried before, but we're just not fully aware yet.
That's amazing, man. That we could honestly have this conversation, I feel like, for a long time. And I don't want to go too far down a rabbit hole because I know you have that hard stop here coming up. But is there anything we haven't talked about yet, whether it's Flow Network, whether it's CryptoKitties? You know, I have a CheezeWizard myself. Is there anything we haven't talked about that you want to like expound on and have a discussion on? Because I feel like you're moving in a lot of different spaces. I know we talked about that before the podcast. You say you have so many roles. What else could we talk about in relation to what you're working on?
Yeah, I think what I'm thinking a lot about today, specifically, like literally today, no, not today, but like in this past like 2 weeks or so, is how do we create a game on top of protocols that drive value to projects in space as well, right? So how do we make, how do we incentivize staking? How do we incentivize governance? How do we incentivize people to do things in certain protocols that don't feel like they're doing work in the network, but making it more like a game itself, right? So it's like creating this game layer on top of other applications itself, right? I think those are going to be classified as blockchain games more than a game itself, right? So the definition of a game is going to drastically change, I think, this year, because we're not going to be sure what a game is.
Wow.
By definition.
This is fascinating, man. You're this is
I
like
a lot of coffee.
It's like the end of a movie here as we wrap up with a cliffhanger. We definitely need a sequel here, man. Have you or Benny on yet again? But there was one thing I promised myself to ask you here. You slightly mentioned it on the podcast earlier, but you talked about IPs, right?
Yeah.
Some of the things that you guys are working on. Are you all actually looking at going out and purchasing IPs, say from existing game studios or other brands like that, and porting them over to Dapper?
It's definitely an option. There are many different models you can do with different IP, right? So we're exploring all different types of ways to interact with IP.
Mm. No, you can't tell us much. It doesn't sound like there, but we'll make sure to stick with Dapper Labs as you guys continue to grow. Like I said, I think it's 2020 is really kicking off with a bang here. And a lot of exciting stuff coming from you and from Dapper Labs, from Flow Network. So if anybody wants to follow along, what is the best way to do that, right? Is it via your website, Twitter? How can people interact with Flow and Dapper and you?
Yeah, so the best way to interact with Flow is twitter.com/withflow_. For Dapper, it's at Dapper Labs _, and my handle is at Flynn Jam.
Awesome. And we always end with one final question, and that is a book recommendation. Could be any genre, could be any category, something that you've read recently or something that's like really resonated with you over the years. Throw that out there.
So I just read, and you might have heard this, Snow Crash, the classic metaverse story, right?
Snow Crash. No, I haven't.
Snow Crash is the defined example of the metaverse. So when you heard, Neil Stephenson is the guy who coined metaverse, and that was by the book Snow Crash.
Amazing. Well, we'll put that in. Any other insights from Snow Crash? Or because that sounds cool.
You'd have to read it and find out.
Mom, a cliffhanger, man. I love it. I love it. Well, hey, this has been an absolute pleasure. Like I said, we'll definitely have you on as Dapper Labs and Flow continues to evolve. But yeah, thanks again. This has been an absolute pleasure.
Yeah, it's been awesome.
Pleasure, guys. Brian. Yeah.
Thanks, Brian.
Yeah, take care, guys. Bye.